now we are ready for question 5 in time value of money. So let's just read the question. Vega's parents also suggest an alternative support. They suggest transferring 2,000 kroner to Vega in the next 6 years, end of year. After that, the support will grow by 3% in all future years. The relevant discount rate is still 5%. What is the present value of Vega's alternative financial support? So that's alternative to what we found in question 4. And which alternative should Vega choose? So in this question here, we are a bit more closer to what teachers often like to do in exams, and that's to combine different elements in time value of money. So you can see here that the 2,000 kroner that Vega is getting in the beginning, that's only constant for the next 6 years. After that, the support from the parents will grow by 3% in all future years. So what we actually have here is a question that combines an annuity with a perpetuity. The combination could also be an annuity with a larger annuity or a longer annuity or a simple annuity with a growing annuity. So the combinations are actually countless here, but we'll just look at one and I'll give you some hints of how you can deal with these combinations. So let's jump into our calculation sheet. So we can call this one present value of growing perpetuity, but it is actually more an assignment in combining different periods. So what do we know? We know that the interest rate is still 5%. We know that the number of periods in annuity equals 6. And we know that because it says in the assignment that during the next 6 years, they will pay 2,000 kroner. Then we have our cash flow in annuity. That is 2,000 kroner. That's what we have here. So that is our annuity. Then we are ready to calculate the present value of the annuity. And that is the same formula as we have up here. We can make a copy to get it down here as well. So that's the first element in our present value here. So let's find it, present value of annuity. And I add this of annuity so the reader of the question here can actually see this is not the final answer. This is only the present value of the annuity at time zero. So we can just do a quick recap of the parenthesis input. If you want to do it in a timeline, you're welcome to do that as well. If you want to use the Excel built-in function here, that's also okay. But let's just see if we can manage to do all the parentheses correct one more time. So this is my C, so my cash flow in the annuity. I start a parenthesis, 1 divided by the interest rate, minus the other side of the input, that is 1 divided by R, multiplied by 1 plus R into the power of T, and I have to close my parenthesis. So you can see here that the value of the annuity equals 10,151 times 38. And that's the value of the annuity. So now we have the first 6 years covered in terms of present value. Then we can jump into our annuity, or sorry, perpetuity. In our perpetuity, we have a growth rate. That is our G, and that equals 3%. When we have a growth rate, you can see that the cash flow here from the annuity that goes up, that simply increases by 3% in all the future years. But it does not start until year 7. So if you have a timeline here, I can just write time and cash flow just to make it very clear that when we do it here, remember that you always start the timeline at time 0. And then you go up. So the first 6 years, we know that it is 2,000, right? So let's just add that. This is an annuity simple annuity, so we have no cash flow today. Then we have 2,000 all the way up here in the first 6 years. But what happens here in year 7? So that's the interesting bit. What happens is that the cash flow from the year before goes up by 3%. So this is how we can find the first cash flow in the growing perpetuity. There you have it. That is 2060. So we can write here first cash flow in perpetuity. And that is my cash flow at time 7. You can see cash flow at t equals 7 if you want to be very specific in the solution. That is 2000. That's the cash flow we have in the annuity multiplied by 1 plus 3% to add the 3% growth. 2060. Now I'm ready to find the value of my perpetuity. You can see I have my timeline here. We will get back to that. So this is not a simple perpetuity like before, but we have to look in our formula sheet and say now we have a growing perpetuity. So let's just copy that in. So we have our formula next to our calculations. I'll just add it here so you can see what kind of formula we are using. So we can now find the present value of growing perpetuity. And what you need to notice here is that this is not the present value at time 0. This is the present value at time 6. And why is that? This is where most people do smaller mistakes in the exam. When you look at the value for a perpetuity, the cash flow that you have here, that is the first cash flow in the perpetuity. The first cash flow in the perpetuity, that is at time 7. That means that the present value we are finding here, that is at time 6. So you can see that these two here, the two colored boxes, they are related. So I find the value at time 6 when I look at the cash flow at time 7. And that's how it works when we talk about these annuities and perpetuities. So the present value of the growing perpetuity, I first find at time 6. And that is then the cash flow, that's the C, here at time 7, divided by the interest rate minus the growth rate. So you can see here that the value of the growing perpetuity at time 6 is 103,000 kroner. Then I can say, but I need to find this at time 0, because I need to find the present value today. If we just go back and revisit some of the theory, remember, only values at the same point in time can be compared or combined. We want to combine these because we want to add them. So we were not allowed to add the 103,000 with the 10,000 here because we would add something that was at the time 0 with something at time 6. So how do we discount this back? We take the 103,000 divided by 1 plus the rate. So this is the formula we had in the beginning of the formula sheet, so the classic discounting formula, into the power of t. And we need to discount it back 6 periods, because we already is 1 period back from 7, because this is how the perpetuity formula is set up. So now you can see we have a value of 76,860 that we can add to the present value of the annuity. So let's just make this bold, so you can see that's a subcalculation. So now we can write total present value at t equals 0. So how do we do that? We simply add the two together. So that is our value of our annuity. That's the first 6 payments. And then the value of the perpetuity that continues forever. And here we have the final result. The present value equals 87,011.57, and that is in kroner. Then The final question in the assignment is that if you should choose the first alternative, that was what we saw in question 4, or she should choose the other alternative here, what we saw in question 5, and of course, she should choose the one with the highest present value. The only thing you can comment here is that, of course, Vega does not expect to live forever, so there will be a large amount of cash flows that comes after she is no longer here. So that's maybe a comment to add. But in corporate finance, you would always pick the option with the highest present value. So Vega should choose the second alternative. As this has the highest present value, and that is 87,011.57 is larger than, you do it like this, 50,000 kroner. Then you would have a conclusion here. So that sums up the things about present values, time value of money, and discounting cash flows. Just remember that the last example here, that's one example of a way to combine two different elements. When you come to the exam, there's nothing to hinder for that your teacher could combine all the different things in here, and even perpetuities as well. So that's just a good thing to practice, and one way to do it is to practice something like this, where you see that you can find the same values with a timeline, the formulas that are given in the textbook and formula sheet, and the built-in functions in Excel.